He was the kind of guy I'd see in those garden supply store advertisements. He had a certain flair with words, this I could tell, although I never really listened to him.
Yeah, I'm going to be interviewing Don's brother from the sauna at the Desert Hot Springs Spa Hotel. This is Kathy, and this is Rollie.
Do you want to talk about your brother and his art?
I don't see too many people these days, so I don't really have an opportunity to talk about him. We're two pretty close brothers that were 2 years apart in our age, 20 months apart. And in Denver, where we grew up, Don started doing caricatures of people in the family and various things that had to do with Indian lore. He was attracted very much to that. So he would do sketches from pictures, and my grandmother saw his talent when he was about 8 or 9, and she said, I've got to get you in an art school. So there was one art school in Denver that was notable, that was the Denver Art College. They had never taken kids that young, I don't think. But she put up the money for the tuition, and he went into that big school as a little kid. And he drew a lot of pen and ink caricature things, etchings, before he got into the actual painting thing. And then when he went to the Denver Art College, that was about 1939, something like that. It was before the war. They chose, I think, about 10 or maybe more of their students to go to Munich, Germany and study there. So he went with that group and became very much in love with a little Fräulein girl there that was doing a PBX job for Hitler, and they finally gave him notice that he had to get out of the country. He couldn't finish out his tuition year. And so he kissed his girlfriend goodbye, and they put him forcefully, almost, on a boat up the Rhine River, and got him out of the country. They were about ready to invade Poland at that time. And so he came back to Denver, and he was in the Signal Corps. They grabbed him and took him in the army. And he spent a great deal of time in Chicago, where he attended the Chicago Art Institute and picked up a lot of good stuff there. And got into some pretty fine artwork because he had gotten that foundation in Munich, Germany, and got into palette knife and some of the other things that were a higher form of the art. And so he had quite a bit of time as in the tow target division to do a little artwork while he was in the service. And then he mustered out about 42 or 3 or somewhere in there, and went back to Los Angeles and had an appendectomy before he left the service. And in that taking out of his appendix, they used a spinal tap. Mm. And that was a kind of an experimental procedure in those early days. So they didn't really know all they ought to know about it. And about 2 weeks later, after he had gotten out of the service, he was in Westlake Park eating his lunch attending some kind of an art thing there, and his left leg started to go numb, and then his right leg followed soon after, and he called his wife. Came and got him and took him back to the apartment, and it wasn't long before he was paralyzed quite rapidly from the leg area on up into the torso. So they took him to Sawtell Veterans Administration Hospital, and they said, "You have arachnoiditis. You're going to be a paraplegic the rest of your life." And wow. He just was really put out about that. And he blamed it on the administration, and they said, "No, it isn't service-connected, because it was too long after you got out." So he went to work for 2 years to put together a portfolio that would bear him up on his contention that it was service-connected. Spinal tap,
yes.
According to my recent information, used to have a preservative in it or something, and they didn't know how to handle that. So evidently this got into a really bad thing in his spinal column. And all just because they used that preservative, according to my information. But anyway, he won his case and got retroactive pay from 3 or 4 years back, set him up pretty well financially so that he could go ahead with his art. And he got a nice home up in Silver Lake area in Los Angeles, overlooking a lake, and they never wanted to sell his work. He just was fixed financially to the place where he didn't need to sell it, and he liked to have it around.
Was his settlement enough for that he could live comfortably the rest of his life?
Oh, yes.
Okay,
yeah,
wow.
They had a big settlement. He won a big case. And so he had this artwork, a 16-foot ceiling with a north light, and it was just a one big studio, his home. So he lived with his paintings. It's all he had to do. That was interesting to him, since he was in a wheelchair. And so he won several art awards. One of the big ones was Newport Beach. They had a song in those early days called "I Believe," and that was the title of his painting, "I Believe," and he showed a married couple with kids walking out of a church. And they presented him with the Art Award of the Year because of that painting. He donated the painting to some organization. And so that was sort of the launching of a career. He was around a bunch of good artists. Bert Proctor was one of them. And they got involved with a school. They on their own, Don especially, had a class in his home, and they had a number of students. So there were some of those early paintings in his life's work that you have that are just partial sketches that were real quick things that were done during the class.
Oh,
there are those little
okay.
canvases. Some of those that he did in the class.
Okay.
And I think most of those serious things that he did, he was pretty faithful about signing. But I guess he didn't sign them all.
There are no dates on most of them.
Okay.
Well, most of that took place right after the war, from 44 to about, in the 50s.
I believe for every drop of rain falls, a flower grows. I believe that somewhere in the darkest night, a candle glows. I believe for everyone who goes astray, astray. Someone will call to show the way. I believe.